All right, guys, Coach Kilburn back again with video number two in our series on our reviews for our industry standard certification test on Adobe InDesign Creative Cloud. All right, so let's go over a few more things that you could possibly see on the test. Okay, one thing, guys, is working with your character panel, right? Character panel, we're talking about working with type, okay? So where are all panels found in Adobe? Yes, you're correct. All panels are found under Window. Okay. Now, we got to go down to Type and Tables. So think about the categories. If you're not sure exactly where things are, guys, just go down the line and look. Which one would make sense, right? We're dealing with characters and type, so Type and Tables would make sense. All right. So guys, you'll see all the things you can find here under this menu item. In this case, we're going to open up our character panel. All right, character panel, control T. So guys, our character panel is going to give us a lot of options for our characters. What are our characters? Anything that comes off the keyboard. Okay, letters, numbers, punctuation marks, right? So guys, the great thing about Adobe is you can hover over an icon and it will tell you what it is. So you're going to need to know what tracking is and how to set the tracking. You're going to need to know what the leading is and how to set the leading. You need to know what kerning is and how to set the kerning. You also need to know your vertical scale and your horizontal scale, right? So you need to know all these things. So guys, look, in this character panel, you can change the font, you can change the font style, and then you can change all these things I talked about, okay? So let's take newsletter here. Let's take this text box of newsletter, right? So guys, look, if I increase the tracking, right, notice it's adding space between every character. Tracking adds or reduces space between every single character, okay? Kerning only does two specific characters. So say this S and this L, right? Okay, guys, and kerning only happens between two characters. So think of just the S and the L. L's don't take up a lot of space. They don't take up as much space as this W. So typography people will go in here and add more space just between two characters. So tracking adds space between all the characters. Kerning just adds the space between two specific characters. Leading is going to add space between your lines of text, right? So here on this text box, I can increase the leading. Notice the lines are further apart. There's more space between the lines, or I can reduce the tracking. Okay. Guys, now they want to make sure you're a human and not a robot. So they may ask you to set the tracking of topic one as the same as topic two. So you have to think, well, how am I going to know what that is? Well, you got to click on topic two, see what it's set on, and then go to the other one and set it that way. Mine are the same here on this example. But on the test, they may tell you to set the tracking or leading or kerning of one layer, make it the same as the other layer. So again, you just need to go and click on that other layer, see what the settings are, and then go and change that other thing, right? Really easy. Vertical scale and horizontal scale is going to make the characters larger either vertically or horizontally. So again, if I click on this newsletter and I increase my vertical scale, right, you see that these letters are now getting taller vertically. If I increase it horizontally, it's going to do the same, right? That's not adding space between the characters like this. It's actually scaling up the size of the letters. Okay, so you need to know everything in this character panel. All right, guys, there's going to be some questions about your layer panel, right? Where do we find all panels? Yes, under Window. So if your layer panel is not open, go to Window and open it, right? So guys, InDesign is a little bit different from Photoshop. We pretty much have layer groups, right? And then all these fall within the layer group. Notice I have another group here. I have a group here, right? I have a group here. So they may ask you to create some groups and put all the text in one group and put all the images in the other group, okay? How are you gonna know what's text and how are you gonna know what's images, right? Guys, look at the layers, right? JPEG's gotta be an image, right? Topic one, text, boom, right? So guys, look, how do you create a new group? In Adobe, any panel that has this symbol here will create a new whatever that is, a new layer, a new swatch, right? A new anything. Just like every panel has a garbage can where you can delete things, almost every panel has this create new indicator, right? So they may ask you to create a group, name a group, and put certain things in that group. Well, here's where you create the group, right? Here's the layer group. I can double click on it to rename it, right? Whatever they tell you to name it. They're probably gonna have you separate the image layers from the text layers. They could tell you to assign it a color, right? If they do, assign it the color they tell you. They could tell you to show guides or lock layer, right? Guys, just reread the question and anything they tell you to do, do that, okay? So there's where I create my group. Here's where I rename the group and assign it a color. And guys, look, I can just drag layers into that group, right? I can just click and drag into that group, right? Boom, drag it up, put it in the group. Guys, now I know it's in the group, right? So make sure you know how to work with your layer panel, right? They could ask you to temporarily make a layer invisible. They could tell you to show the hidden layer, boom, right? They may tell you to delete a layer, right? Guys, simple, easy, not hard. All right, guys, they will probably have you work with your swatches. Again, where do we open our swatches panel? Yes, every panel comes from window. Now, guys, look, now I got to think, all right? I don't see swatches. Oh, my goodness, I'm stressing out. I'm taking the test. I'm freaking out. I don't know what to do. I can't find my swatches. Think. Out of all these categories, what would swatches possibly be under? If you're not sure, just go down the line. Start hitting everything with one of these flyouts, right? Anything that has a flyout. Oh, color. Swatches deal with color. Oh, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Let's go to color. Let's go to swatches. Okay. So, guys, look, again here. I can create a new swatch. I can delete a swatch, right? I can create a new color group and name that group and put certain colors in that group, right? So, guys, look, they may tell you to change the color of something that has a particular swatch, right? And change it so it's another color of a swatch, right? So these things are grouped. I got to go up here and ungroup them so I can find out which swatch color I used, okay? So maybe move the stuff over here. All right, that's grouped. So we got to ungroup that, right? Boom. So let's see what color we used here. We got to ungroup that. No, we're good. So guys, look, here's the color we used. They could tell you to lower the tint or change the tint, right? They're probably going to tell you to change it to one of these other preset swatches, right? Boom. I just click on it and it changes it, right? Again, click on the item they want you to change, right? In your swatches window, it'll show you the color that's currently on. They're going to tell you what to change it to, okay? Again, guys, they may tell you to make a new swatch based on an existing color, okay? In that case, right, I can come here, right? Let me maybe go here, right? I got to ungroup that. How do I know to ungroup that? Because I got a little question mark right here. It doesn't know because there's multiple items in there. So I got to ungroup that. Boom. There's the swatch. They may tell me to make a new swatch based off that color. I got to click on that color. So InDesign and Adobe knows what I'm trying to base the swatch color off of. And then I can create the new swatch here. Right? They'll tell me what to name it. Right? You can open it up. You can change the color mode of the swatch. You can change the type of swatch. Right? You can change everything here. All right. So guys, make sure you know how to work with swatches. So guys, also with swatches, they may tell you to delete any unused swatches. Guys, I'll be honest, when I took the test, I didn't know how to do that. That was very new to me. I never heard of deleting unused swatches. So I didn't know what to do. So what I do, I opened my swatches panel, that's for sure. Then I just started looking, right? How do I know which one has been used and which one has not been used, right? So hover over things, see what they are. Boom, oh, I remembered that most all Adobe panels have these series of lines up here, right? Look at all these panels. Anytime you see a panel and it has these series of lines, that's giving you more options. They can't fit everything in this panel. It'd be too cramped. There's just too many items. So I said, let me go here and check. So I clicked there and I just started looking. New color swatch, new gradient, new color group, duplicate, delete swatch options, load swatches. Select all unused. Holy crap. I got lucky there. Look, select all unused. Bam, look, it highlighted all the unused swatches for me. Then I reread the question. What did it tell me to do? It told me to delete all the unused swatches. I just click, drag these to the garbage, boom, get that question right. So guys, again, you may not know what to do. It may not have been on the Geometrics practice test or training. I may not have taught you. They purposely put items like this on the certification to make sure you're not a robot and you're not a human. So if you're not sure where to go and you know the right panel at least, start hovering over things and then check these lines, right? They'll usually give you what you want. Guys, they may tell you to save as a CS6 or CS4 or before. Those are old versions. CS and numbers were before Creative Cloud, right? So CS4, CS6, they're older versions. You just go File, Save As, right? They'll probably tell you what to name it, right? They'll probably tell you where to save it, right? And then look at our options. 2020 document. Guys, on the exam, it may say 2018 document. Don't worry about it. It's not a big deal. We're just using the latest version of 2020. So on the exam, if it says InDesign 2018 document, that's it, right? And then you're going to have a template, right? Again, on the exam, it may say 2018 template. Not a big deal, right? And then boom, look. Here's all the older versions. So they're just going to tell you to save a document, name it, where to put it, and save it as an older version, right? Document is our new version. Template is something we can open that's already pre-designed, and then we can change that pre-designed template. This is older. Why would you save as an older version? Well, let's say your client that you're working with or your team member you're working with, they don't have the most up-to-date Adobe InDesign. Maybe they have an older version. So you can save your file as an older version and send to them, and they can open it up in their older version. So you just need to know how to do that, okay? All right, what else may we see on the exam? Okay, guys, they may have you convert text to paths or convert text to outlines. So let me pull this text over here. I'm going to zoom in real close so you can see good. Guys, right now it's text. Text is basically vector. Text is not made of pixels or raster. They're made of smooth lines and shape based off mathematical formulas. We call those vectors. So guys, really all your text and all your shapes, they come out vectors. You can rasterize them. You can turn them into pixels, but the quality is going to look much better as a vector. So right now I can get my type tool and I can get in here and I can edit this text. Right? But sometimes you want to convert your text to artwork or outlines, right? let's say I'm using this font here, right? I'm using Bauhaus 93, but the printer I'm using does not have Bauhaus 93. I don't want them to have to go online and find Bauhaus 93 and download that font and then use it. They're going to charge me money for that. So anytime I send my artwork to printers, I always convert my text to paths, right? How do you do that? You go up to type, right? Think about it. Makes a lot of sense. I'm working with type. I would go to the type menu, right? And then guys, look, create outlines. It's going to convert the text to paths or outlines. Okay. Now if I zoom in, there's paths around that text, right? See the blue lines around the text? I cannot now go in with my type tool and change it. It's not text anymore. It's outlines. So then now I can treat this like artwork, right? I can come up here and I can add effects to it, right? Because it's now artwork, right? Just know that once you convert your text to outlines or artwork or paths, all the same thing, it's just like an image. It's just like a shape, right? It's no longer text. I can't use the type tool. Just know that, okay? Let's go to view, fit, spread, and window. Boom, nice. Guys, they may have you work with hyperlinks, okay? Again, text, window. If you're not sure where to go, just start going to all these things that have these flyouts and start looking for something with hyperlink. Or think, use your brain. Okay, hyperlinks are interactive. Hyperlinks are interactive. Why? Because the user has to click on it and then it takes them somewhere, usually a website. So they may have you add a hyperlink. They may have you change the address of the hyperlink. Just depend. You just need to know where the hyperlinks are, right? And then you just do what they tell you to do on the test. Okay? So they tell you to put the address in. Right? Boom. Now I have a hyperlink, right? Boom. There's my hyperlink. Guys, they could tell you to delete the hyperlink. They could tell you to change the address, right? They could tell you to create a new hyperlink, right? You just do what they tell you to do, right? Look, guys, these lines always have options. So again, guys, we're going to end this video here, right? So it's under 20 minutes. Remember, guys, look for the panel that you're looking for. Think which category it would go in. If not, look for it. Find anything with a flyout and just look for it, okay? When that panel's open, know that all panels have create a new. We can delete them, and then we always have more options up here, right? So guys, on a test, you just have to be a human, not a robot. Think, click around, look. Try your best. You're going to do fine. You're going to pass this exam.